Many people, when they build a house, build from scratch, from new. Some people, of course, restore or extend a house they're already living in. But the couple I'm going to meet this week are going to spend the next 12 months recreating something they have lost. This is the story of a phoenix rising from the ashes.
Years ago, Alex and Cheryl Ray left London for a new life in the New Forest. They bought a run-down medieval thatched cottage and lovingly brought it back to life.
It was like we were living a dream. We used to wake up Saturday mornings and go, you know, is this our place? Are we really in the countryside? So from that point of view, it was a real find.
Then, just before Christmas, with Cheryl pregnant, disaster struck.
It was all just really kind of a surreal blur for the next 12 hours, 2 weeks. It was just, you know, there was a series of events. It was like living in jelly. It was just all sort of slow motion and just very odd.
The fire, which was caused by a faulty chimney, was barely out when Alex heard the worst news.
I called up the insurance company to be told that our policy has actually lapsed. My immediate reaction was vomiting. Just in disbelief. It was kind of a kick in the nuts, I think the phrase would be.
Overnight, Alex and Cheryl had lost almost £400,000. And whilst most people would have walked away from this, Alex and Cheryl couldn't let go of their dream. 9 months after the fire, they've decided to start all over again and rebuild the cottage. Bigger and better than before.
Morning.
Morning.
Hello.
How you doing?
How do I get in?
Round this way.
All right. Hello.
Hi.
You Cheryl?
Yes, I am.
Pleased to meet you.
How do you do?
Hi, Alex. Hi.
Pleased to meet you, Kevin.
And you, who's this?
This is Bieber.
Hello, Bieber. You all right? I cannot believe you guys. Anybody else would have just given up and wandered away from this project. You are bonkers, aren't you?
Probably.
Yeah, completely nice.
What kind of state is this place in?
It's seen better days. We'll come and have a look.
Oh my goodness. There's nothing left, is there?
No.
What remains standing looks as though it's about to collapse anyway.
Well, most of this damage was done probably more from taking care of the fire than the actual fire itself. So when they rip off the roof, everything gets thrown down. It's all these beams here that are all kind of snapped.
Goodness me. How does it feel coming back?
I hate it. But I've got a bit better throughout the year.
Are you still traumatised?
Yeah, by... I am. When I come in this part of the house, I can't stand it.
You look very uncomfortable.
No, so I don't like it here at all. Not this bit.
What's to
but
say...
Once we start really moving, then it'll feel...
You sure? I mean, yeah. What's to say that you won't feel any different when it's finished?
No, I think it will just be you know, that feeling that you've achieved something that was so awful. You know, we've got through it and we can make it better again.
Alex and Cheryl aren't just planning to restore the cottage. They're going to use this opportunity to make something really special, fusing traditional building methods with contemporary design. All that remains of this 16th century cottage is the ground floor. The kitchen and the living room were relatively undamaged, so they'll be cleaned and restored. However, the other half of the ground floor was severely burned, so here the damaged walls will be demolished. And the whole space opened up to create a large, light and open dining area with a new central staircase. The top half of the cottage will be entirely rebuilt, giving Alex and Cheryl the chance to transform it. A new green oak frame will be constructed on top of the existing brickwork to make the first floor. Two brand new oak frame extensions will almost double the size of the old cottage. At the front, the traditional cottage dormer windows will be restored. But the back will be a revelation. Here, the oak frame will be filled in with large plate glass windows, giving a contemporary twist to a traditional style. By adding so much glass and leaving the oak frame exposed to ridge height, Alex and Cheryl will create a very light and modern home. Upstairs, there'll be three bedrooms, three bathrooms, a study, and a large master suite with wet room. Despite the fire, Alex and Cheryl have decided to restore the thatched roof over the main part of the house. The side extension close to the neighbours will be roofed in slate. Alex and Cheryl have given themselves a year to bring this house back to life, and they're hoping to borrow the entire build cost of £200,000. Although he's never done anything like this before, Alex has given up work in the music business to project manage the build.
So why are you doing this? I mean, why don't you just sell this place up, move on?
Well, if you're very passionate about it, it was a very old building and we need to save as much as we can.
It's our home.
What's left. And the thought of anyone pulling everything down would just break our hearts. And I think we can make it better. I think we can build it bigger and make it better.
I mean, there's two ways you can look at this. You can either look at it as a house half burnt down or a house half built. And we've chose the latter.
But that is a very big risk, isn't it? Because, you know, there's Cheryl saying she could hardly walk in the door of the place. There is no guarantee what you're going to do. We'll get you through this pain. We'll heal you.
We've just got to try. I think we have to try. I think, you know, it's something we've got to do.
What happens if you fail?
We won't fail.
But this is going to be anything but easy. First, Cheryl's job as a record producer means she and baby Bieber will be in London, whilst Alex is living on site.
Yeah.
Then there's the money. Cheryl and Alex already have a £350,000 mortgage on their flat in London. They're also repaying a £300,000 mortgage on the house that burnt down. And because they didn't have any insurance policy at the time, they're going to have to take out another mortgage of £200,000 to finance the rebuild, making a total of £850,000 in borrowings. Now, the trouble is, they haven't agreed the £200,000 that they need for the rebuild, and having started work, well, they're just spending money that they haven't got. Two years ago, Alex and Cheryl Ray's perfect cottage in the New Forest was destroyed by a chimney fire. Discovering they weren't insured, they lost everything. But instead of walking away, they've decided to create something even more special than before.
Yeah. What are we doing first, then?
I think we can start taking these Aeroco beams out.
Yeah.
Although the mortgage needed to pay for the build hasn't been approved, Alex is eager to get started, and he's employed his friend and serial house renovator, Barclay Johnson, as site manager. And professional builder, Danny Broadley.
Okay, up. And again.
The only money coming in is from Cheryl's job in London.
What I don't understand is why doesn't Alex stop working here, go and get a proper job in London, earn some decent money, and then pay a labourer down here? It's far more financially efficient to do that.
I think he feels happier being here, being part of it. Yeah. It's that whole process of, you know, I'm building my home for my family and I will be here.
The caveman thing.
The caveman thing, yeah,
but, I mean,
absolutely.
Are you happy about that arrangement? Because it puts a great deal of pressure on you. You are taking on a lot personally yourself.
Well, I don't know. I mean, I just cannot wait to be able to stand up and look at it and go, we did this, we got through it, we did it, and we built it ourselves.
Although there's still no sign of the new mortgage, Alex continues to spend money on the build, getting Barclay and Danny to measure up for the timber frame. This will sit on top of the existing brickwork to form the first floor.
Yeah, go on there.
Normally, the timber frame company would take these critical measurements themselves, but to save money, Alex is gambling on Barclay getting them right.
Because the walls aren't straight, and they are leaning out and all sorts of other idiosyncrasies. So somebody has to go around and measure them all accurately so that the frames can produce a frame which identically matches the idiosyncrasies of this building.
A month into the year-long schedule, and once again Alex is trying to run before he can walk. He's already agreed to pay the timber company £45,000 to make the new oak frame when he gets some very bad news.
We thought we had all the finance in place. We found out that the mortgage company were pulling out for various reasons. Unfortunately, it's left us, well, particularly me, very stressed because we'd committed to a lot of the big costs on the build, particularly the frame, which makes up about a quarter of the overall build.
Without the loan, Alex and Cheryl are in trouble. They have to find £200,000 to pay for the build or risk losing everything.
Most work now is ceased on site. We'll just tidy up the site. Not exactly put it into mothballs, but we'll also do a fair amount of planning of the stages, schedule work, so that'll help the finance company, give them a bit of confidence in that we can see how the job is going to work.
Yes, no worries.
I'm amazed that Alex has been able to keep his mind on the job because it's a real strain. So it must be torture.
All building work stops until Alex and Cheryl can find the money.
So how do you keep going? I mean, how can you keep going with all this stress?
It is quite hard, but you know, I think something good's gonna come out of it at the end, so yeah, no, it's exhausting.
So you can still hold on to the dream?
Yes, it's not worth it otherwise, is it?
To keep their dream alive, Alex has no choice but to hit the phones.
Well, everything, the roof and the first floor and the whole lot was destroyed bar the living room. Realistically, £200,000.
After 6 weeks and having been turned down by 17 different lenders, Alex finally convinces a bank to loan them the money to complete the project.
Lovely. All right, mate, take care.
So tell me, as an arch blagger, how did you manage? I really need to know this because not many people are capable of this. How did you manage to borrow such a vast sum of money? What's your trick? What's the secret?
Well, I don't like to, I think blagging would definitely underrate my skill of persuasion.
Okay. What are your skills of negotiation and persuasion?
No, I think, to be honest, more than anything, it was determination. I mean, our reserve energy levels were very low and Cheryl obviously had to focus on work. And I tried every different avenue going until, I don't know, I remember years ago I saw this sign, you know, you never fail until you stop.
Clearly the cash is great news, but the bank have insisted that Alex and Cheryl sell their London flat by July, taking 2 months off the schedule. Alex now just has 8 months to finish the cottage, or Cheryl and Bieber will be homeless.
Afternoon.
After a six-week layoff, work resumes. And with his eye on the budget, Alex persuades some mates to help out with the heavy lifting.
He's on.
Got the kettle on.
To prepare for the timber frame, the cottage walls need strengthening with these 7-metre oak beams.
Toby, Carl, Rich, you front.
These new beams will help spread the weight of the oak frame across the fragile medieval brickwork.
Don't get your shoulder on it, mate. Just watch it. Just in case.
Each beam weighs more than 2 tons, but with that macho muscle and Barclay at the helm, the team work like a medieval machine.
Put one in the middle. Are you guys coming down onto this level? 1, 2, 3, lift. Back, forward.
As long as you know.
Going straight through.
Win!
Well done, guys.
Win! Absolutely fantastic.
Didn't think it was going to go in then. I thought it was going to go a bit pear-shaped.
With their technique now perfected, the second beam goes in much more quickly.
Guys, well done. Thanks. Easy. Pint o'clock, isn't it?
Pint o'clock.
Done.
At the timber yard, the oak frame is coming along nicely. I never thought I'd see today. Today is the day that the timber frame finally arrives on this job, except, of course, that it's not going to be without its complications. Because, in fact, Alex and Barclay have done all the site preparation for the timber frame here. The timber frame company have had nothing to do with that. And he's also ordered the crane by himself, a very special kind of crane. And the timber frame company don't like that one little bit. They'd normally supply the crane and driver themselves. But Alex has gone and hired his own crane, saving hundreds of pounds. Problem is, the framers don't think it's up to the job.
Because Alex has taken on responsibility for the crane, if the crane is deemed not suitable, not safe, then we will have to stop the lift and discuss where to go after that. We either hire in a crane that we do trust, or we stop the operation until that operation can be safe.
And the crane isn't the only worry.
Well, I'm very apprehensive about how the timber framework is going to marry up to the existing brickwork of the building. I've done all the plans, measured it all up several times, and we'll only really find out whether it works when it goes up. And that'll be by the end of today.
Smack it again. That's it.
Much to everyone's relief, the crane performs and everything slots into place.
Well, we've got frame one in. Frame two is just gone in, just been flown in. And frame two is the heaviest frame. So the framers have been able to see exactly what the crane can do, and fingers crossed, I think they're happy.
It's the last purlin going in.
Fantastic.
How do you feel?
Brilliant. Finally see shape to a home.
It's an incredible amount of work for one day, I think, isn't it?
It is.
To put all this in. It's gone from being basically a shabby, nasty wreck.
Mm.
And it's turned into a building with extraordinary character.
Mm. And I can see the rooms now as well. You know, you can see where that ensuite's going to go, that bedroom's going to go, and it's actually bigger than I thought.
Stuck in London, Cheryl is feeling less positive about the project. So how does it work, dividing up the time between up here in London and down there in Hampshire?
I feel a bit alienated at the moment.
Do you?
Yes. Because I haven't been able to spend any time there. But I think once the roof goes on, then, you know, there'll be more involvement. I will have to be. I have to keep an eye on them.
Yeah, somehow. I don't know how you're going to find the time.
No, I just have to make the time.
Whilst Cheryl juggles her job and Bieber, Alex is flat out on the build, wrestling with the chimney that caused the fire. Having consulted engineers, the best advice is to rip it down and start again.
Yeah, it's very kind of cleansing process insofar as, you know, because obviously all the, you can see all the black and the tar and the soot build up in there, which is obviously the causes, the common causes of fire. So to get rid of that, it's kind of like cleaning out all the old sort of dangerous stuff and then putting in a new system. It's refreshing, really.
The new chimney will make the house safer, but it's more money and more time.
We've had the chimney flue, complete rebuild thrust upon us, which is going to set us back because it's not a simple job because there's other people involved and structural engineers. So the pressure's been on the last couple of weeks and definitely we've been all feeling it.
And fitting new specialist fireboards to the roof is slowing down Alex and his team even more.
We are delayed at the moment by about 2 or 3 weeks.
1,300 millimetres.
But we're coming to the final day or so of the fireboarding, and then the thatchers can start.
These calcium silicate fireboards will shield the roof for up to an hour, giving fire crews time to strip the burning thatch and save the building.
We've done the fireboarding ourselves and I decided that's something I wanted to do because obviously it's the most important factor of fireproofing the house. I wanted to see every little square inch of it capped and done correctly.
Fitting the boards puts all Alex's management skills to the test.
Not yet. When you've burnt some wood, we need a round of T's, OK?
The fireboards aren't the only change to the roof. In Alex's part of the New Forest, traditional thatch is made from wheat straw. But Alex wants to use water reed from Norfolk. He's keen to support a small group of reed cutters using one of the last reed beds in England. This hasn't been approved by the conservation officer. But that doesn't seem to be stopping Alex, who's brought his thatcher, Simon, to inspect the reed.
Simon, would you like to have a look at this? So I think that's a fair representation of what we're producing.
That's nice. That is good.
Looking at it at the moment, it's looking quite encouraging. It's a nice colour. Overall, I'm pretty happy with it. It's a nice, tough reed. It's straight, it's clean, it's been well cut. And overall, you can see it's got a real nice, sort of tidy butt to it. I think it's going to look nice on the roof.
Well, Simon may think the reed is top quality, but Alex is once again charging ahead without thinking of all the consequences. Before the fire, Alex and Cheryl's house had a roof on it made out of combed wheat straw from a nearby field, like this one. Now, the local authority's official line is that that house has to be repaired like for like, and the conservation officer wants to see a roof made out of straw. The trouble is, Alex has set his heart on Norfolk water reed, and if he puts that on his roof, the chances are he may have to take the whole thing down again. Six months into the build, the reed for Alex and Cheryl's thatched roof has arrived from Norfolk.
Excellent.
And it's the size of Norfolk.
Would you reckon, Si, send it back?
Yeah, send it all back. No, it's good. They've been hard at work, haven't they?
There's so much of it. Massive.
Yeah. It'll take Simon and his team of thatchers 8 weeks to lay the 2,500 bundles of reed on the roof.
Well, the thatch has arrived finally, and it's huge. I think it's pretty significant insofar as with the fire, obviously, and it burning down with thatch, how confident now I sort of feel with what we're doing and putting the thatch back on. It's not, you know, I always thought this moment I might feel a bit kind of nervous if I made the wrong decision, should we insisted on using slate, but no, it's beautiful and I love it.
Alex may love it, but he still doesn't have permission to use it on his roof. With just 4 months to go before they have to sell their London flat, Cheryl cracks on with selecting interior finishes for the cottage. Back on site, with the July deadline in mind, Alex and the team push ahead to get the roof finished. After just 5 days of thatching, the intricate detailing around the front windows is taking shape.
Look at this. Horizontal thatch there. Thatch here, perpendicular to the window. 45 degrees here, 30 degrees there. A beautiful shape here and a lovely moulded curve at the bottom. Now, that is only obtainable with the very finest reed and also the very finest craftsmanship. And none of this has been cut. This has actually been pressed, tapped into place. And it hasn't even had its final little shave yet.
Simon, the thatcher, is using techniques that have hardly changed in hundreds of years.
I'm surprised. This reed, look, you've still got the flowers on the top, the seed heads.
Yeah, it's quite heavy.
Is that how it's meant to go on?
Yeah.
That's traditional.
Yeah, it fills out the roof and all the rest of it.
There are some, you know, there are some building processes that you can sort of understand easily.
Yeah.
This is not one of them.
No.
Little bits and tools and lots of things going on at the same time.
Yeah, there's more involved than people think. They just think we'll, you know, be here for a couple of weeks.
Yeah.
And that's it. And we'll be on jobs for 8-9 weeks.
So you can let me have a go?
Yeah, go on.
I'm going to create for you the one point in the roof
here
that
we go.
Leaks.
I'll hold the reed for you first.
Yeah, thanks very much, because I've already... Bloody Nora!
It's going everywhere. Right, if you lift up that rod there first...
Which one? The steel rod there?
Try and get this underneath.
You're going to hook it underneath there, right, OK.
That's it. You need sort of three pairs of hands.
Right, and then you've got to...
We'll lift that up.
Lift this up.
That's it. Now...
This is only temporary. That's
just going to be... That's right.
Yeah. Next.
Push that into...
Push it in there.
Nicely in there.
And then I'm using this T-bar here...
Yeah, to hold the set back.
To hold that back in, so I'll get...
Lovely.
So that holds them in.
That's it. Hook there.
This thing.
Yeah, careful with that. It's quite sharp. Just cut that string.
Thanks very much. Right, string goes.
There you go.
And then, I love the way that actually all of your tools can be secured in the roof.
That's great, yeah.
You know, they go flying off.
No, not at all.
And then
you just pat that up. Oh, yeah, they're natural. If you get that leg it.
Now, my question to you is, Simon, can you tell the difference?
Well, I'm trying. No.
You sound really surprised.
With the original building nearly restored, Alex and his team start work on the extensions.
Here's to the frame.
To the frame.
Cheers, Alex.
Once the timbers are all in place, the framers hold a traditional topping out ceremony to bring good luck to the house. And luck is something Alex is in need of because the conservation officer is about to make her final decision about his roof.
This area of the New Forest is an area where wheat straw is the predominant thatching material. So we weren't at all happy with Alex going ahead and ordering water reed, and certainly not putting it on the roof, not happy at all. But when we established that actually he's supporting an industry that's in severe decline because of the importation of foreign reed, we actually felt that we could overlook it in this case, and we're certainly not going to ask him to strip it off the roof.
Well, arch blagger Alex has got away with it. In many ways, the fire has allowed Alex and Cheryl to not only rebuild, but also redesign parts of this project, like the large rear windows. They can also reinvent their family life that Alex enjoys all too rarely in Hampshire.
Now, I'm trying to think, Cheryl, the last time I saw you with Alex was when I first met you. And ever since, I've seen you, yeah, I've seen you in London by yourself, you know. So how do you manage to move the build on then between you?
Well, I constantly update Cheryl. We send anything from, like, you know, picture, you know, messages to, and then email her photographs, and then we try to sit down with plans at the weekends.
I mean, does that work, doing everything by email?
It is starting to make sense, and now we've got to sit down with the plumbers and electricians, and I'm sure things will change again slightly, but I'll come down more often now. I have to, because it's getting to that those last few months.
Lots and lots of decisions.
Tons. Yeah.
So when, what was it like when you last saw it indoors?
Well, it's cleared out. All the rooms are cleared now, which is fantastic to be able to see the shape.
So you can see the space. The original configuration of this, though, was very different, wasn't it? I mean, much more dense, you know, much more pokey, and lower ceiling.
That was a typical rough cottage, really.
Yeah. What do you use this for, this room?
Well, it's a bit of a big hallway, open plan dining room, yeah. And then it follows through to the kitchen and the living space.
Yeah.
Living
it's
room.
All linked.
So you're able to circulate around the whole of the ground floor?
Yeah.
Without hitting your head?
Yeah, we could have like a little chariots of fire race around there.
Of course, when we first met here, you said you were really uncomfortable about this building. You didn't enjoy coming back to it.
Yeah, it was very frightening. I've really just felt quite sick, obviously.
How are you now about it?
I'm really excited now. It's fantastic. It's so different upstairs. It's amazing up there now.
Yeah, I think upstairs is kind of...
It's phenomenal now, yeah.
I mean, downstairs is a success, and it's certainly more usable than it was, but this is where it really takes off, isn't it? I think upstairs is like a medieval hall, you know? Mm. They've done all this oak work. Don't you like it?
I love it. I'm in love with it.
I mean, it's... I mean, to have all this on display, to have cheated this extra headroom, I think this is a huge success. Then you've got that gable through there, haven't you? And beyond that, the space over the garage.
Yeah.
So
it's huge. It's huge, though.
Just live up here, frankly. Yeah. Timber frame, I think, is a fabulous success. I think it's testament to how well this design has worked, you know? However, this thing, I do not understand. That old brick flue you had sort of meandered its way through the building.
Yeah,
you know?
It was really crooked as well.
It looks great at the top now. It looks great downstairs where you rebuilt it. This is crap.
It won't be when we finish it.
What are you going to do to it?
We need to make a feature of it, because it's obviously the reason why the house burnt down in the first place.
Yeah.
So what we're going to do is Alex is covering it with boards, and then we're going to find some fantastic tiles and make a feature out of it. Without it being too obnoxious.
Oh, you mean like a sort of like one of those kind of great big Swedish glazed chimneys?
Yeah.
Yeah, that would be a lovely idea.
That
actually.
Would be, no, I like that idea. So it'll be covered in tiles.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Oh no, that's
yeah.
And then
we'll have a fireplace in here in this bedroom, and then obviously the huge fireplace downstairs. Mm. So
it's the link between the old parts, really.
Yeah.
You know, conservation brick and the old fireplace, and it's the kind of modern link.
I'm relieved the whole thing's come down though.
Because it might have come down by itself anyway.
Well, I just thought of it happening again. Terrifying. So I'm actually really, really relieved that we've got a brand new chimney.
The chimney is now safe, although the extra work means that the July deadline is approaching fast.
You're slightly behind schedule now, aren't you? By about what, 3 weeks? A month?
Yeah, but there's a few tasks that we're going to sub out to pick up the speed,
right.
Like the drywalling, and the guys are going to do it in a week, where it would have took us 4.
But you can't bring this in on time at the expense of going hugely over budget, can you?
No, but there's a balance. It's where you pay the money. Do you pay it up front now, or do we pay it in interest afterwards?
So when are you due to finish?
End of August.
And how far over budget will you go in order to achieve that?
Well, the budget will be over about £33,500 overall, but that's not dependent on picking up that time. We made that decision in February to give ourselves that cushion.
So are the bank happy about
that?
Yes,
absolutely.
They've lent you that extra?
Yes.
For many people, £33,500 would be a lot of money to borrow.
It is a lot of money. The bottom line is, when we analysed it a couple of months ago and went back to the bank, there wasn't one direct cost that was outrageous. It was a lot of little bits. There was the chimney particularly. It's not like we've gone, oh, I know, we want gold tiles, for example. It's all in construction costs, and it's all in direct labour costs.
But having more bodies on site to make up for lost time creates a problem in itself.
It's almost like the development starts like a snowball on the top of the hill, and it's really hard to push it.
440, yep.
But once it starts going down, you can't stop it. And things are overlapping, trades are overlapping, materials are overlapping, you've got to make decisions quick. And when we started off, we had sort of intense periods and then periods when we could sort of relax and think. And now it's just intense periods when we've just got to think on our feet all the time. And that's probably when you've developed, you know, for years or, you know, many times, it probably wore off a duck's back. But for us, it's been quite sort of stressful in making sure everything comes together.
With the first fix well underway, the final plans for each room have to be signed off.
And then the layout on that wet room.
This one in the corner?
Yeah, we've still got issues with that because we've got the old double sink issue again, I'm afraid.
I thought we'd...
No, we'd solve that, but the boss, Cheryl, our client, wants to find a way to work it.
She wants two sinks in here?
Somehow.
Have you told her it's not a TARDIS?
I have told her it's not a TARDIS. Original plan from this, we were going to have the shower tray that way,
yeah.
Raise the plinth, toilet there, single sink central here.
I think that two sinks is difficult.
Two sinks is difficult, but that's what the client wants, so we've got to somehow make it happen.
If you've got the space, you can, but if you haven't got the space, you can't. It's impossible. It is not a TARDIS. You've only got a certain amount of space, and you only fit a certain amount of things into that space.
We've got to relook at the layout and the story.
Barclay and Danny clearly have to spend several days trying different sinks out to please their client while the roofers get on with some real work. Alex and Cheryl have gone for Welsh slate. It's an expensive option, but they're keen to make sure their additions do justice to the old cottage.
So you're bringing the glass up through the house?
Yeah.
For that end gable?
That end gable.
And this one here, some's got to come up through.
The two big ones will come up through. Well, they can all come up through and we can pass them out.
Right.
Now that the roof is on, the large glass panels can be fitted at the back of the house. This is the final transformative element and perhaps the most radical new idea in the build. But even though Barclay and Alex made templates for the glass suppliers, the panels don't seem to fit.
Have you tried it in here?
No, I'm just going to do that. It should be that one, because that's the bigger pane. That's the bigger opening.
See, because when we supply the template, the top of the template definitely dips down on that corner.
Yes, well, yeah.
The problem we're having with these is the two pieces of glass, when they are joined together with this strip of mastic, they've been stacked on an angle so that one piece has shifted against the other. Consequently, the overall height in this case is about 10 mil more than it should be. That's why we're having troubles getting them into the slot.
With a bit of nipping and tucking, the glass panels eventually slot into place. The build is moving into the final stage. Alex and his team are working all hours, and he really looks like he's suffering for it.
Coming to it now, I feel absolutely knackered. It feels like a battle, to be honest, with the kind of just constantly on the budgets and trying to move things along and making those off-the-cuff decisions. So I'm pretty knackered.
But the cottage is still unfinished. And with the London flats now sold, Cheryl and Bieber are having to camp with friends. They're homeless. Yeah. 18 months ago, Alex and Cheryl Ray's dream cottage was nothing more than a burnt-out wreck. But after a Herculean effort of refinancing and rebuilding, it has been quite transformed.
Hey, Alex.
Good morning.
How are you?
It's a nice welcome.
Feeling like they're formed up.
Yeah, you're looking, you're not looking as perky as your missus.
Oh, no. I have to say.
Or is this house? I tell you what, Cheryl, I love that ridge. That's you, isn't it? That's your design. I wasn't expecting it to be so big. It really pulls all right down, doesn't it? Right down the roof. And it's kind of thick and chunky and...
It's very chunky.
Yeah, quite Tudor looking.
Yeah, it was carefully planned with Simon L. Thatcher.
And beautifully detailed. All the strapping work he's done around the chimney.
Circles and diamonds, yeah.
Yeah, really, really nice job. Are you pleased with that?
Oh, I love it. Absolutely love it.
Nice. Very, very cleverly done, then.
Yeah.
Now, I'm a little nervous about going inside, because every time I've visited, nothing's changed.
Oh, no, it's still a building site.
It's exactly the same.
Gosh, what a place. What a very nice house.
Thank you.
When can I move in? Well, I love it. I love your style, guys. This is my kind of house. Oh, it really is.
The kind
of
mixture of taste.
Really, the mixture of old and new and all this wood.
Yeah.
Which is terrific.
We like wood.
No, I could happily live here.
That's very nice.
Well, it's a lovely mix, isn't it? You know, the old walls and the oak frame.
Just as the rebuilt rooms retain the lime-washed bricks of the old walls, so Cheryl has treated the oldest part of the house with equal sensitivity. The sitting room, untouched by the fire, has been cleaned and painted and furnished with thick, chunky textures that are redolent of the outside of the building.
And the other thing, I guess, is that, you know, not only have you got this much cleaner open plan arrangement, but you've got an easier access from all of this, both and into the kitchen.
Absolutely.
Yeah. Oh yeah, no.
So that you can live in it in that very 21st century way, in that much more fluid way, rather than in a series of medieval pokey boxes. Hang on a minute. This is your old kitchen, isn't it?
It is. Yeah, we saved some of it. Yeah.
But you changed the doors.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
And put a top on.
Well, we actually took the whole thing apart.
And rebuilt it.
Well,
it's a nice job. I didn't think this kitchen... look, it survived the fire, that's one thing. Surviving use as a site office and canteen for all the guys here, that's quite another. Amazing that it emerged unscathed.
Yeah.
It was a shocking mess when they were all here.
It was! This is lovely, though, tying it all together with this cast top. This is beautiful, this acrylic, isn't it? Mm. Lovely stuff.
I just love the way it curves.
And the breakfast bar.
Yep, we kept a piece of the green oak.
That's nice. Through. Again, it's like that room, it's like the front of the building, it's like this mixture of the very, very clean, sheer new with the kind of all the textured old stuff as well.
Yeah.
Whilst the ground floor has been restored and remodelled, the upstairs has been transformed by the Darth Vader lookalike medieval oak space frame.
Oh, gosh. That's nice, isn't it? That the height and that great curve of glass over the bed.
Mm.
Isn't that just a delight? What a light room. This oak, you've had it all sandblasted, have you?
No, we sanded it.
you sanded it?
Yeah.
Jeez, you're joking. That's a lot of work.
It was a lot of work. A
huge amount of work, but isn't it beautiful?
We did a lot with just hand sanders.
Oh my goodness, this is the block work chimney that I said looked crap, didn't it?
Yeah.
Still does, really.
Yeah.
When are you going to cover it?
What do you mean, when are we going to cover it? I sweated over that tiling.
You put them on yourself?
Yeah.
You really have... you've earned quite a few trays, haven't you, in the process?
Yeah, that nearly broke me. Not tiling it up. It was actually the last three tiles, which I think went for about three boxes, to go around the flue.
Oh, to get the curves and the shapes and the rest of it.
Yeah.
Cheryl might not have won her battle to get two sinks in the ensuite, but this is no longer a cramped medieval cottage. The double-height ceilings and large windows upstairs introduce light and space and connection with the landscape outside.
This is some view. Never really seen this before properly.
No.
The interesting thing is, isn't it, it's kind of this glazing is so big, it's like the building reaching out into that landscape.
You feel that you're in the garden, definitely.
Well, it feels like you're out there in the marshland, looking at the birds. But it's got a door on it.
It will have doors, we haven't done that yet.
Is that the plan?
Yeah.
It's going to be a private space.
This will be a private space.
We've got the green oak, we're just looking at making something special for the door, huge door.
Alex and Cheryl have made such a huge emotional investment in this build. But now it's over, I wonder whether the wounds left by the fire have healed.
Tell me about your relationship with this building now. Where do you stand with it? Is there a bit that you particularly connect to?
I do think this room is very special because it survived and the beams survived and the fireplace, oddly enough, even though that's where it all started, survived, and it's the oldest part of the house.
Yeah, I mean, we're looking at that lintel above the fireplace. You can see the initials of people.
It's only since Bucks, you know, put cleaned the oil up. That we've started seeing
it's
it.
It's never been cleaned up this well before either. Yeah. It wasn't cleaned like this before. You didn't notice things in it, and like you do now, so.
But what about you, Alex?
The room I really like is the big bedroom overlooking the garden.
One with the bath in it?
One with the bath in it.
It does deliver, doesn't it?
It does.
Standing in front of that glass, you look out, you look over the...
I get up in the morning, walk to Bieber's bedroom, get her, have a look on the way and have a look on the way back with her every morning. That's why I'm kind of, we haven't quite put the door in yet, really, because it was kind of like, I don't want to have to open something to...
Well, maybe you shouldn't.
No, maybe we shouldn't.
So tell me about the cost of the whole project, because last time we spoke, you were a little bit over budget and you'd spent £233,500 as against £200,000, which was your original budget. So where are you now?
£250,000.
All in?
Yeah.
Done?
£250,000, all in, done.
So, how cool are you about that? I mean, how cool is the bank about that?
Really cool. I haven't got any problems with them. It's been fine.
Because anybody else, given the money, given the opportunity, might have cut and run, might have built something else somewhere else. You've done this not for money. You've done it entirely for love.
The fact that we've come through this, and as a relationship, what it's given us and the strength it's given us, to be honest, I think we could deal with any shit, really. You know, that's what I'm grateful for, what this house has given us. It's stressful, it costs us a few quid, we've had a nightmare, but we've got through it. And we can pretty much stand, you know, I mean, she's even tolerating my snoring now.
There are 100 ways to rebuild a house like this, and of course Cheryl and Alex chose the hard way, the route that was financially crazy, creatively challenging, and that took in repair and craftsmanship and a lot of brave architectural ideas as well. And you may think of architecture as being sleek and shiny, but actually the way that this place resonates to its own history, the way it responds to its setting, to its own rebirth, thanks to the dedication and passion of the people who own it. That lifts it from its very humble origins and really does take it into the realms of proper architecture.